that's talk about the species diversity, whereas ecosystem diversity talks about the number and variety of ecosystems or habitats within a particular region. So these are the three major levels of diversity. And let us see what is of genetic diversity. So genetic diversity is always plays an important role. Variation of all living forms at the genetic level, genes, alleles, or nucleic acids, that gives a huge amount of varieties. After some period of existence, they all will become the species. Like this, it goes on. A variation is the law of nature. Variation is the law of nature. Variation starts at the genetic level. Any changes at genetic level that implies on the phenotypic characters of the particular species, and also it gives the a particular species to adapt to the environment. Genetic level of diversity is always very, very important for any species to adapt its environment. Any species cannot adapt to its environment. Survival of the fittest, which is not able to survive, which is not able to fit to the or suit to the particular environment, it cannot survive, and nature will withdraw that particular species. So for this, each and every species try to modify its genetic structure and get some adaptations so that it will well suit to the environmental changes time to time. So you can see here the number of colors, certain colors of kernels, it's all because of the changes at genes. And these are all various banana colors. That's again with the change of and human beings. Region-wise, national-wise, continent-wise, you can see a number of variations among human beings is all because of the genetic combinations. And you see here brinjal, first one, next one is a tomato, and paddy, a pumpkin. These are all varieties, so many varieties. In paddy, there are nearly more than 1 lakh varieties of paddy available today. They're all at Rice Research, International Rice Research Station, Manila, Philippines. They are having more than 1 lakh varieties of rice. So these are all because of the change at genetic level. So genetic level of diversity also can be utilized in the genetic engineering technology, where we can change the form, we can alter the structure of the organisms and get benefited. And here are some GM foods, genetically modified foods. You all know the technology behind it. And introducing the desired genes into the particular species, particular plant or animal, and we're getting these things. And you know the popular golden rice, where they've introduced the gene to produce the vitamin A in rice itself, so that the poor man can eat the rice along with the vitamin A. No need to buy the carrots, no need to buy the costly food to get the vitamin A. By taking rice itself, you'll get the vitamin A. That's the main idea behind it. And, you know, flavor of the fruit, taste of the fruit can be changed. Apple with the orange flavor, and even shape also possible to change. Orange with the kiwi, or banana with the kiwi, and the color of the pineapple can be changed. And you see watermelon, general watermelon color is this. But now in market, these are all colored watermelons are available. This is because of change at genetic level gives you these many varieties. Okay. Genetic engineering gives you to combine the characters or to get the new things like flavors. You want different flavors in one fruit, that's possible. Or you want to change the color of the fruit inside, that's possible. This is all just manipulating the genes gives you a diversified things. So this is all about the genetic level of diversity. And here you see one more thing. This is a BT cotton, everybody knows it. Bacillus thuringiensis gene is introduced into the cotton plant so that the cotton plant can produce the harmful substances when bollworm eats the fruit or the leaf of this plant, cotton plant. The gut of that bollworm get ruptured and it will die with the starvation. So this is the idea behind it. And once introducing of this BT cotton, there is a reducing of the pesticides, and that again help the environment in many ways. So that's all about the genetic level of diversity. And let's come to the next level of diversity, that is species diversity. This is a composition of all species in a given ecosystem. And it's a result of a long-lasting evolution. You know, all evolution doesn't take place within minutes or within days or within years. It takes millions of years for to evolve some species, new species. Okay, but evolution leads to the formation of new species time to time. And that fulfills the gap of a particular species which we lose by the extinction. And the services they rendered can be fulfilled or replaced by the new species. And that's not our role. This is the role of nature. Nature look into this. And then evolution is always a rule of the nature, and time to time it will withdraw some species and it will introduce the new species to the environment. Each species has adapted to its own niche. So to adapt, adaptations are very, very important here. And these adaptations are again based on the genetic vigor. And so that it can tolerate the temperature range, availability of food or light, whatever, any problems or any climatic or edaphic, whatever the problems the species face, these can be overcome by the changing at a genetic level or getting some adaptations. And in natural state, species always interact within the species or in between the species and with the ecosystems. These are all interactions. A continuous interactions make the system in a balanced state. Otherwise, the system will go into imbalance, and that leads to the again, a destruction of the some more species. So what is the significance of the species diversity? Species diversity is always plays an important role in a particular locality. And when a species get extinct, their services for the global biosphere are lost forever. Remember, a species, any species, whether it is an ant or elephant, irrespective of their size, shape, if we lose one species permanently in the form of extinction, the services which the species provides to the nature, we lose that services permanently, and it is impossible to replace those services by any other thing. Unless otherwise, nature again involved and introduce other new species. Until then, those services will lack. And the loss of one species affects many other species. This is again a cascade effect. You know, the food chain, primary producers and primary consumers, secondary, tertiary, like this, it goes on. If we withdraw any species between, or if we withdraw secondary consumers, tertiary consumers are the first one will affect on this. And again, the other species which depends on, again, they will get affected. Like this, it is a cascade effect. It will show very bad effect on the entire food chain, or sometimes it's a food web, because there are many interlinks. And any species that will take over the lost species niche will most certainly not replace all of the functions it used to perform. Of course, other species may come and occupy that niche, but the proper services cannot be fulfilled. What exactly the services we got from the extinct species cannot be replaced by the existing species. That's the very importance of the species diversity. And here some mushrooms and bean diversity here, and species diversity. These are all various species living on the earth. Already I told you, we are one species after all. We are one species among all other species. There are millions and millions of species, and each and every species has equal right to share the things, equal right to live. But many times we think that we are the superiors and we grab all the resources from them, and we are leaving a dirty environment, unclean environment to them. That's again putting them under threat. And next important thing is ecosystem diversity. Ecosystem diversity deals with the variations in an ecosystem within a geographical location, and its overall impact on human existence and the environment. So there are different types of ecosystems: mountain ecosystem, desert ecosystem, a grassland ecosystem, marine water ecosystem, fresh water ecosystem. Like this, there are many ecosystems existing on the earth, and each and every ecosystem supports a unique type of species. Of course, again, they have their own adaptations with that they are surviving in the particular ecosystems. You cannot bring the cactus into the marine ecosystem or freshwater ecosystem, or you cannot take the freshwater plants or animals to the desert ecosystem, because in every ecosystem they have their own particular niche, and there they are adapted to that ecosystem with some adaptations. So this is an ecosystem diversity. Ecosystem diversity leads to the diversified animal and plant species with the suitable adaptations. And each and every species is unique in its form, in its structure, in its shape, and in its functions also. That's a very, very important thing. So all the living entities and the ecosystems completely forms the biosphere, and what we talk about the biodiversity. So value of biodiversity. Why to talk about the biodiversity? Why to read about the biodiversity? Why to think of the biodiversity? So biodiversity has an intrinsic value, something that has a value in and of itself. The word itself, the biodiversity itself includes all living organisms, and each and every organism is unique, and the services are also unique. So that's a great value. And the services provided to the nature also very valuable. And what we get generally with the biodiversity? We get oxygen, we get a food, we get a clean water, we get a medicine, aesthetics, ideas, and many more things. So today we are seeing deficiency of oxygen. In India particularly, there is a dearth in the production of oxygen. So when I was a child, my teacher told in the classroom, in some countries, people used to buy water. we lost it teacher, and by hearing that, what a funny thing, why people buy water, but today we are buying water. Because those days water is available everywhere, no contamination, no pollution. But now all the water resources are polluted, and very few resources are available, and that only they are for the sale, and we are buying. That's a very pathetic situation. And within soon time, we also we definitely will buy the air also. The day will come if the things go like this. Yeah. So here you see one interesting thing I would like to put. Fine bottled water hails from Japan. This is from Japan and is naturally filtered through the ancient volcanic rock from deep below Mount Fuji. So the volcanic rock that used to filter the water and to create a mineral rich water and completely pollutant free water. So now they packed it and they put for sale. You know, the price of this water, just 750 ml, it costs around $5. $5. That's the price of the water. You can imagine how precious water is, how precious the natural things are. But we are not caring about the nature. And in the name of development, we are moving ahead just by ignoring the all natural resources. If you say, put each and every natural thing for the cost, we cannot pay, no one can pay for the natural things. That's a value of the each and every natural resource. And biodiversity is good for humans because we get many different products from many different organisms, like a food, meat, eggs, milk, veggies, and different things, different products we get from the nature, medicine, penicillin, and there are many medicinal plants still. People are depending on even allopathic medicine is also getting or extracting some medicines from the plants, clothing, wood, oxygen, protection, etc., etc., etc. This is all because of the natural resources. And here are some important plants. We get a bromelain drug from the pineapple that is used for control the tissue inflammation. And some are anti-cancer agents like a colchicine that we get from the Colchicum autumnale, and also Vinca rosea, Vincristin, and Vinblastin. And anti-malarial drugs are also available in the nature. That's a quinine drug we get from the Cinchona officinalis or Cinchona ledgeriana. And some plants, some drugs cures the fungal infection, particularly the thymol that we get from the Thymus vulgaris. And anti-cancer agents, particularly treat ovarian cancer with the drug Taxol, which we get from the Taxus brevifolia. These are some important drugs. Of course, there are many, but few I have mentioned here. And the plants used in traditional systems of medicine, particularly the ancient system of medicine, that's Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, homeopathy medicines, majorly the drug source is the plants. Drug source is the plants. And here the contribution shrubs 14%, climbers 21%, trees 28%, and 37% comes from the herbs. And that a particular part, plant part, leaves 46%, bulbs 2%, seeds 11%, goes on. Fruits, bark, flowers we use to extract the medicine or drugs. And the family wise distribution, this is here. This graph is showing available of medicinal plants from family wise. And Indian system of medicine use 90% of raw material derived from the medicinal plants. Among these, Ayurveda, 30% of the medicinal plants are used in Ayurveda, followed by the Siddha system of medicine. And next, 23% goes with the Yunani, 10% with the Western and other medicine systems. See, some very important antiviral herbs I'm putting here because of the present situation demands these antiviral herbs. Ginger is the best antiviral plant, particularly that rhizome, gingivorous nail, and followed by the garlic, Allium sativum, turmeric, curcuma longa, green Andrographis paniculata, Calendula vaginalis, and Olea europaea. These are the plants which are the best for the viral diseases and controls the virus. At and next, nowadays people are encouraging the immunity also. Every product immunity booster, they are writing immunity booster and putting for a market. So natural immunity boosters are also available from the nature. Nature is giving these herbs to improve, to enhance the immunity. Ashwagandha is the best one, followed by the licorice, tulsi, amla, ajadrakta, and turmeric. So people are bending towards the alternative medicine than the Western or allopathic medicine because it has many side effects and people are getting more awareness and turning towards the alternative medicine or ancient system of medicine. So like any the Yunani, Ayurveda, Siddha, homeopathy. But again, it's putting more demand, more pressure on the exploitation of the plants, And there is a decreasing of the these resources, plant resources particularly, because to prepare the medicines, drugs, and all these, they're exploiting more and more. If the plant is of the particular organoleptic part is a root, there is a chance for the putting the plant for endangeredness and for extinction also because of over exploitation. And how biodiversity supports the farm profit, how it supports. See here, soil microorganisms and plant roots, so that we get healthy soils, like some bacteria, nitrogen fixing bacteria, which is available in the soil, or the earthworms, and all these helps the farmers to get the healthy soils and ground cover, deep-rooted perennials. They have the water retention capacity and they maintain the moisture, and also they stop the soil erosion. And bees, birds, bats, and other insects, you know, their valuable services in the form of pollination, already we discussed. Without these, we cannot imagine the survivability of the plants. Without plants, no living entities can be seen on the earth. The next one is water cycling can be done by the plant roots, burrowing critters, and roots that pack soil plant atmospheric connectivity. So from soil, plants absorb water and release it into the atmosphere in the form of transpiration, so that the water is recycled. That can be done. That's one of the important aspect. Legumes, stock. And you know, here I would like to bring the Goetz here. Goetz is a very famous phytogeographist. He says that vegetation of a particular locality decides the climate of the particular area, and climate decides the culture of the people. See, there is a connectivity between the culture and the plants. vegetation of a particular locality decides the climate of the area, and climate of the particular area decides the culture of the people. So this is the connectivity. And legumes, stock, organic matter, soil microbes, and these are all enriching the soil, and recycling of all the nutrients takes place. And native vegetation, beneficial insects, all act as a pest control. And here, native vegetation is very, very important. And we are losing this native vegetation. There is a threat, a lot of threat for the native vegetation by the exotic plant species. Already, we are seeing many exotic plants have entered into the India, and they have acclimatized, and they have dispersed to the each and every corner of the India. And there is a lot of threat, huge threat to the our native vegetation, because there is a allopathic action called they release some chemicals into the soil to control the growth of the native vegetation. And meanwhile, they grow very rapidly and occupy more and more spaces and grab the all nutrients. So that our native vegetation or our native species, plant species, get cornered, and these exotic plant species occupies more and more. So that gives the our native vegetation, puts the native vegetation to the threat, endangered, and conditions goes like this, they will extinct. So next we'll go to the magnitude of the biodiversity. How the biodiversity is magnitude? See here, there are mega diversity centers of the world. We can see here the Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, Mexico, Zaire, Madagascar, Australia, China, Indonesia, India, and Malaysia. These are the very, very important sites where you can see the diversity of animals or diversity of the plant species. You can see in these spots. These are only the centers now supporting the many of the animal and insects and plant species. If there is any disturbance in these areas, again, these biodiversity centers lose their diversity and lose their services. But present situation is not in favor of the nature or not in the favor of diversity. Human destruction is going on, and there is a huge amount of species we are losing every year from these sites. Reasons for richness of biodiversity. Why this much richness you can see in particular localities? What's the reason behind it? Diversity of environment. Environmental factors always shows a tremendous impact on the species. So particularly climatic conditions also sometimes they favors or sometimes they harm the species. So in these areas, the environmental factors are always good and supportive, so that the richness is also more. A wide range of climatic conditions, so that helps the plant species to adapt or to get more changes. And the richness we are seeing in that particular localities. Conditions for evolution are optimum. Evolution are optimum here, and extinction are lower. That's why every year new species, new varieties are coming out from these areas, and they are surviving as new species, and extinctions are low. That's why the richness is high in these areas. Distribution of biodiversity. How the biodiversity is distributed here? So now biodiversity comprises of various life forms, tiny to small to or micro to macro, and species constitute the currency of the biodiversity. We can say currency, a richness. Some areas I've shown you, they are very rich in biodiversity. So species always can be called as a currency. 100 species are there, and that itself are rich in that particular locality. 1,000 species are there, more rich. Like this, we can say a particular locality, low number to high number, wherever the locality with high number of species, that is always rich in biodiversity. So species can be called as a currency for the biodiversity. To assess the biodiversity, one should study the species diversity and geographical patterns of the species. So species always plays an important role. Number of species is always very, very important. Variation is always important. So nature always goes for the variation, doesn't want the uniformity. Nature's law, it's a nature's law. Variation is a law of nature. It never allows the uniformity. But nowadays we are seeing, we are destructing the forest. Deforestation is going on, and we are going for a monoplant cultivation, like eucalyptus or some other plants we are cultivating. Only one type of plantation we are going. So that's not at all good for the nature. That has a very bad impact on the nature. And hotspots, the word generally we use in the biodiversity. It's a very, very important word, hotspot. To qualify as a biodiversity hotspot, Mayer's 2000 edition, he given some guidelines. And one species said to be, one area said to be hotspot, it has to qualify two important things. One is it must contain at least 5 to 0.5 to or 1500 species of vascular plants as an endemics. Then only that can be, that area can be declared as a hotspot. And it has to have lost at least 70% of its primary vegetation. These two things are putting that area, can be declared that area as a hotspot. So endangered, endemic plant species, 1500 endemic plant species are present in that locality. You know the endemism. Endemism plays an important role here. Endemism is nothing but a confined to a particular locality. There are different plants in Telangana also, like Tirocarpus antlinum, that's endemic to the Nallamala forest. Or if you go to the Tirupati, Cycas bedomai, or Pimpinella tirupatensis, they are endemic to the Tirupati hills. Like this, different plants, different regions, different localities, they are endemic. Any area consists of the 1500 species endemic to particular locality, and the area is disturbed more than 70%, that can be declared as a hotspot, and governments or some NGO organizations can take up that area for conservation. And around the world, there are 25 areas qualified with these two point criteria and declared them as hotspots. These are all various hotspots declared worldwide. There are 25. We too have two hotspots in India. One is Western Ghats, and the other one is here Eastern Himalayas. Okay, these two places declared as hotspots in India. And you know, these two places with a great number of species living there, and richness is high. And this Indo-Burma region said to be, or this northeastern part is said to be a cradle for angiosperms. Angiosperms evolved in this place and dispersed to the various parts of the world. And nature gives the time for the each and every species. If you go to the Jurassic period is era, golden era for the dinosaurs as well as the gymnosperms, huge gigantic gymnosperms flourished during the Jurassic period, nearly 200 to 300 feet height Jurassic gymnosperm plants were flourished. And during the course of time, what happens, nature withdrawn or cornered these gymnosperms to the particular localities. And it has given opportunity to expand and occupy the more and more area, more and more area by the angiosperms. So during the course of evolution, nature supports some organisms for some period. After that, either it will withdraw that species or it minimizes the size of that species to the particular locality, and it gives opportunity to the new species to the expand. And our human beings evolved very recently, Cenozoic period, very recently evolved, and nature has given opportunity to the Homo sapiens. Now we occupied all the Earth surface, and we are moving to the other planets also. And of course, we don't know how long nature support us to expand. If the things goes like this, the imbalances goes like this, nature definitely will take a revenge. And what we are seeing today is pandemics and all these. See, nature always try to put the things in a balanced state. There is any imbalance, it applies the different things and put the things into the equilibrium state. So in India, we have two spots. One is the Eastern Ghats, and other one is the Western Ghats, and other one is the Eastern Himalayas. They are supporting varied species. And this is the biogeographic map of India. Because of varied climatic conditions, if you go to the north side, cool climatic conditions, coming to the south side, somewhat hot climatic conditions, and you can see the desert, or you can see the Himalayas and valleys, great valleys, and also plain lands and Deccan Plateau. These are all mountains, mountain regions, and all gives the varied type of environmental climatic conditions. This favors the this gives the uniqueness to the India in the world, and it has the, its own diversity. And diversity in the culture, diversity in the vegetation, diversity in the different languages and the different ideas also we have. So magnitude of the biodiversity, when we talk, there are some terms we should apply. One is endemic species, next one is the keystone species, umbrella species, and the flagship species. Any doubts people are getting? I don't know. I mean, because this is a platform, online platform, I cannot see you, but I'm moving ahead. Can I continue?
Yes, sir. Yeah, you can.
Okay. Yeah. So endemic species, keystone species, umbrella species, and flagship species. So let us see endemism. Already we discussed endemism is nothing but it is confined to the particular locality. Except in that locality, the species is not found any other where. So that species is called endemic species. So endemism occurs when populations of one species are separated, so they cannot interbreed. And so there are some barriers. There are some barriers. Those barriers restrict that species to stay in that locality. So they cannot expand and confine to the restricted to that environment. So they are called as endemic plant species. These are all barriers put them in the endemism or endemic called as endemic species. The endemics are not randomly distributed across the earth, but they are clustered and are called centers of endemism. The centers of endemism. So many plants and animal species are endemic, and you can see a great number of patches distributed all over the world. And the distribution of endemic taxa is used to identify the area for protection, preservation, and conservation. This is very, very important. When we talk about the endemism, endemic plant species or endemic species, any species, endemic species, the area should be protected. Otherwise, if any disturbance in that area, you know, recently the Kalivikodi, which is endemic to the Kadapa district of Andhra Pradesh, there was a project proposal by the some industries. Later on, they come to know that there is a existence of this bird called the Kalivikodi that is endemic to the particular locality, and they stopped that project immediately. Crores and crores rupees they invested, but finally they stopped that project to save that one species. Because if there is any disturbance in that locality, it will go for extinction. A small species, one species, of course, but once it go for extinction, we cannot bring it back. So for the concern of such a species, endemic species, these areas are should be declared as a highly protection and preservation of conserved areas. Then only we can conserve these endemic plant and animal species. Otherwise, they're very sensitive, very sensitive species. Any disturbance comes there, either climatic or edaphic or environmental or human interfered conditions put them for endangered and extinction. And most of the endangered sites are becoming sensitive because of the anthropogenic activities. Anthropogenic activity, only human interference. Otherwise, nature, most of the time, nature never struggles with those species, but human interference only, many species are at a threat. And biodiversity and endemism, the endemic species play a very important role in these following aspects. Biography of that biography of the country of or island. So centers of speciation, they said to be centers of speciation because they evolved in that area, and because of no time or because of barriers, either physical or genetic barriers, they cannot expand, and they restricted to the particular locality and have become the endemic. And those centers are said to be speciation centers. And the areas of extinction also, because they are confined to that particular locality, disturbances put them for a threat, vulnerable, and removal of that species. So those areas are highly sensitive and also called as extinction centers. And extent of variation, we can see the variation also, because each and every species is unique, and particularly the endemic species is highly unique. And the services are also highly unique, because that restricted to the very small area in the world, very small area in the world. And adaptive evolution of species. So these are all important things we should remember when we talk about the endemism. And other important species we talked about, keystone species. So keystone species play a very important role, very dramatic role, and they always put the things in a equilibrium state. So there is an imbalance because of these keystone species, nature is getting balanced. Otherwise, whole things will go imbalanced. That's why these species are called as a keystone species. So sometimes the abundance of one particular predator has a dramatic effect on the abundances of many other species. So here you see the sea otter. The sea otter, and these are called sea urchins, and this is a kelp forest. You know, kelp forest is the shelter zone for many organisms. And these sea urchins, they feed on these kelp forest, and they destroy this kelp forest. And these sea otters feed on these sea urchins. Sea otters always controls the population of the sea urchins. Otherwise, what happens? And nowadays, the number of these sea otters is decreasing. If it is continuously decreased, what happens? They cannot control the sea urchins because number is low, sea otters number is low, and sea urchins number will become high more, and they eat out more and more of kelp, and they destroy more kelp forest, and all the organisms which are taking shelter in this kelp forest will become shelterless and will get affected, and they all will become either endangered or extinct. So one species is protecting all other organisms. Yeah, many organisms at least. So they are called as a keystone species. So here one example is sea otters. And next one is umbrella species. Umbrella species occurs within or migrate across large areas. And why they are called umbrella species? Because the umbrella of their home ranges includes the habitats of other wildlife species. Just it gives the shelter to the many number of species. One species gives the shelter to the many number of species. Just you see Ficus bengalensis. If you go to the Calcutta, there that Aura Botanical Garden, you know, hundreds of acres it expanded. And coming to the Mahabubnagar, Telangana state, in Mahabubnagar district, Pillalamurri, it also expanded to the hundreds of acres land, one plant. So it is supporting n number of species. And it's a shelter zone for birds, bats, insects, many microorganisms also. So such type of species are called as a umbrella species. They are also very important for the nature. If you cut one plant species here, Ficus bengalensis, which occupied more and more area, and all other species lose their shelter. You know, some places if you see, one Ficus bengalensis holds the 50 to 100 honeycombs. Honeycombs can be structured to this Ficus bengalensis. 50 to 100 also you can see sometimes. That means they are called bee trees. They're called bee trees, and bees prefer such type of trees to build their cones. They're very supportive. So such species are called as umbrella species. And the flagship species, this is another term we are using. This is nothing but any species chosen to its some environmental cause, such as an ecosystem or in need of conservation. And because of their charisma, we choose these species as a flagship species, and their vulnerability also, their endangeredness also sometimes we consider, and the destructiveness in order to best endangered support and acknowledgement from the public at a large. Here are some species you are seeing. All these, some are at endangered, some are at vulnerable, and some are Royal Bengal tiger, it's a cherishma, king cobra, it's cherishma, and panda, it's a vulnerability. They have chosen as a flagship species, and they always remain high. Bengal tiger is a proud species for India, a proud species for India. And Ongole bull is a very proud species for Andhra. Okay, so because of that charisma, their uniqueness, it gives the it puts the that species as a flag, and people look at. And if you go to the I think Madhya Pradesh, some black hen, black I forgot the name. Black hen. I don't know. Locally, it's called Nallakondu. Anybody knows that name? in Madhya Pradesh, particularly Madhya Pradesh locality, okay. Anybody knows the name of that hen, black hen? The meat of that black hen is 1,000 rupees per kg. That's available in all markets, chicken markets.
Yeah, I think the Kadaknath, sir.
Yeah, Kadaknath. Yeah.
Yeah.
Kadaknath is also that can be put, named as a flagship species for that area. So Union for Nature and Environmental Protection, peer committee every year compiles registers. One is a red data book, other one is a green data book, and a blue data book. So red data book talks about the threatened species, green data book talks about the rare plants, and blue data book gives the detailed information on endangered species. So here some books, red data books, threatened birds of Asia, and threatened birds of Asia, other one. So we are entering into the part three, that's the loss of biodiversity, how we are losing the diversity. See here that sparrow, house sparrow, once upon a time, it was in an endangered condition because of NGOs activities. Now again, we are seeing these birds here and there. The number has increased. So how we are losing the diversity, let us see. Many of the species we lost so far. And if the conditions are like this, we have to see them only in the museums. This is only the option. But no care from the man side, because many reasons. We'll discuss all those. But still, we are not following proper steps to protect these species, valuable species. But we are interested to see them in the museums. Each and every species is valuable. Once it extinct, it's permanently gone. So these are the direct causes, putting the species for extinction or losing. So habitat loss or fragmentation is one important aspect because of the construction activities, developmental activities, road construction or building constructions or many constructions, putting the habitat in fragmentation, so that once the habitat is fragmented, some species goes to other side and some species come this side, and between the road act as a barrier, and no copulation or no contact between these species, and that put them into threat, and slowly they will wind up. And climate changes, it has more effect on the species. Climate is very dynamic. Every minute there is a change in the climate, and nowadays we are seeing very worst conditions, extreme conditions. One side floods, and other side drought, and everywhere, not only a particular area, everywhere we are seeing. Just last March, it was touched to 45 and 50 degrees centigrade. So it's extreme. Actually, these temperatures generally we see in May end, but beginning of March we have seen. So these extremes are all because of the human activities, unsustainable use or management. So our development must be sustainable without causing any harm to the nature. The development should be, but nowadays no one is bothering, and even the policies, government policies are not in concern of the species, and the development, whatever taken by the governments or public or private sector, that's all unsustainable. That's leading to the species for extinction. And other thing is domestication. domestication of some species, putting other species for extinction, introduction of exotic species, either intentionally or accidentally. You know, while importing the wheat from the America to India, Parthenium histophorus plant have entered, and now it is acclimatized to the all parts of the India. So the pollen is highly allergic, and also it shows the allopathic action, and it secretes some of chemicals, and it controls the growth of our native vegetation, and it expands more and more. An interesting thing is here, if the conditions are good, it goes to up to the 6 feet height and comes to the flowering and release the seeds. And conditions are not favorable, this it grows to the small centimeters and immediately it comes to the flowering and it releases seeds. So it can survive in any conditions and release the seeds and distribute to the different parts. So that's the capacity of that exotic species. And another species that Prosopis zuliflora, intentionally it was spread many parts of the India by the government and, those days to use this species as a firewood so that there won't be any pressure on forest. That was an intention by the government, and spread it to the many parts. Now it is acclimatized and spreading more and more, and causing problems to the our native vegetation. Trade in species, many species, valuable species, knowingly or unknowingly, many of illiterate persons, they don't know the value of the species, and simply they go for hunting and putting them for trade. That also leading that also decreasing the species, natural hazards or events, and human induced disasters, forest fires, podo or jhum cultivation. This jhum cultivation still we can see in some tribal localities in Assam, or if we go to northeastern part, many of the northeastern areas still we can see, even in Telangana, Khammam, Edurallapalli, in such areas. People are practicing it, of course, because of intervention of government and other NGOs, it has come down, but some activities are going on. These also destruct the forest and lose some vegetation or species. So merciless killing of animals. A few years back, some people entered into the Nehru Zoological Park, Hyderabad, and they entered into the enclosure, and they taken out the tiger out, and they killed the tiger there itself, and taken the skin out and went out. So that was very pathetic situation, because of the value of the skin, people are killing the animals, particularly tiger. And even elephants. So forest destruction and fire every year, huge amount of forest is cutting off and losing resources. Forest fire recently, Amazon forest, how badly affected the environment, took some months to control that forest fire. During that course of time, very valuable species caught in that fire and died. Okay, and as per some studies, they say that nearly 50 to 100 species gone for extinction because of that fire. And hippo dilemma, habitat loss, introduced species, pollution, population growth, overconsumption. So hippo, these are important aspects, putting the species, animals or plants in dilemma. These are all, many are man-made, but no one is caring about. So here, some species don't die off, but are altered during the evolution. even human also, when was the Neanderthal age to modern age, and you like to evolve as a robot. Some people are trying to take their brain and put their brain in the robot and want to get an eternal life. So maybe in future it may be possible, and we will see only the robots with the human brain. That will happen. Okay. So other species vanished completely, like dinosaurs and other species gone off. And
sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
If you don't mind, please you stop the screen share, and then only you have to start. Some of the participant write on the screen.
Yeah, please don't scribble on the screen. Don't mind. Yeah, I'll stop. Are you getting bored?
No, sir.
Yeah. Is it okay? Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there are five mass extinctions took place in the history. So one is at the end of the Ordovician period, and next late Devonian, end Permian, and Triassic. And now four mass extinctions, and fifth mass extinction is getting ready. Maybe that's Anthropocene extinction, human extinction, because already I told you, each extinction leads to the devastating of the millions of the species gone off. And nature gives the time for one species and its luxurious growth, and it will withdraw. The time for evolution, or the time for formation, the time for withdrawal, we don't know. So here, you know, God, many of us believe in God. G-O-D, G for generator, O for operator, D for destroyer. Who generates, who operates, and who destroy the things, we call it as a call him as a or as a god. What is same role can be seen by the nature. Nature here creates, generates, operates, and at the same time it destroys. One who believes in God also should believe in nature. One who respects God, one should also respect in nature. If you don't respect the nature, if you believe in God, the things are not in a proper way. So because many people ignore the nature, and they never protect the natural things. That's a problem we are seeing today. Very abnormal things we are seeing today. So maybe the fifth mass extinction is ready for us. We have to wait for the fifth mass extinction. Already nature giving some warns, like Spanish flu 100 years back we have seen, and after 100 years we are seeing the next great pandemic. This is a COVID. These signs are coming out from the nature, but don't know whether we follow the signs of the nature or not. If you don't follow these signs, and same attitude will have, definitely nature take a great revenge. When dinosaurs were there in Jurassic period, nature has given a great chance to the dinosaurs, huge gigantic dinosaurs, and because of that huge gigantic body, while roaming, the pedestrian movements killed the many organisms. So later, nature withdrawn the dinosaurs by the some asteroids, some people say, and some people argue that starvation deaths, that extinction of the dinosaurs because of starvation, no availability of proper food, maybe. So now conditions are very worse. Definitely it will be, the next extinction will be for human beings. So again, at least we should listen to the nature and should respect the nature and try to give something to the nature. So we lose these species, important species recently, not bring them back. Of course, nothing is forever. No one is forever. At least the time we are spending here, we should contribute to something to the nature. What we are taking from the nature, in some form, we should give back to the nature. That will extend our lifespan on the earth. So indirect causes, what we have seen, those are direct causes, and these are the indirect causes: inequality and poverty, population pressure. You know, population is raising up, particularly in India, density is more. So the pandemic is also spreading fast than other countries because of the density of population here. And national and public policies, some national policies and public policies also sometimes, because of course, most of the policies, public policies in concern of the human being, in perception of the human being, not in the concern of the other species. This is putting many species under threat. Ineffective governments, many countries, some governments are not bothering about climate or not bothering about the nature, just in the name of development, their policies are taking and moving ahead, that putting the species threat. Social attitude of the people, people are not bothering about the nature. Even you see last pandemic, last year, when lockdown was there, people were in the house, and after 1 year, people are with the same attitude, no change in their attitude. They want to go for meetings, they want to gather at marriages, or they want to celebrate something, you know, same attitude. They're not changing their mindset. So that's worst hit of the pandemic, COVID hit for second wave in India because of this attitude. And microeconomic policies and structure. So these are all indirect causes, of course, have a great effect on the species loss. Human impact on nature, if you see, these three important things played a dramatical role. Man in nature, early hunter-gatherers, as a hunter, he hunted many animals and lost very important species during the hunting process. Still, people are hunting. From early primates to the now modern age, people are still hunting and putting the species for threat. And the shepherd and farmer, you know, large desert, that's a Sahara or Thar desert. Once upon a time, there were the grasslands. Because of overgrazing and browsing activities of these sheep and goats, they turned to the deserts. And even now, some parts of the Anantapur area, some part of the Mahabubnagar Nagar in Telangana, in future, they will turn to the deserts if the activities are like this. And you know, industrialization, it's a worst scenario. Of course, for the development, it's a mandatory, compulsory. But once industrialization started, pollution, and that caused the very, very, very bad effects on the nature. And cultivated land across the globe is another scenario. But the growing population, we have to convert the land, more and more land for cultivation. And for that, we have to cut the forest. And the species which are living in that forest, they have to move away. And finally, many of the forest land converted to the agricultural land. You can see in the map, very small area is under the forest, remaining all converted to the agriculture. And particularly human impact, if you see, increasing population, increasing use of finite resources, and increasing pollution. Population, for the needs of population, we are grabbing, we're exploiting more and more resources from the nature. And, you know, you go to the small village also, you can see real estate. Agriculture lands are turning to the real estate and construction pressure. People are constructing houses, factories, and all these. So this construction pressure, removing the many species from their habitats. So human beings are encroaching into the forest and destructing them. So animals, forest animals particularly, they are questioning us where to live. That's why we are seeing these animals in our areas. They're coming into the human settlements, villages, towns, they're coming, they're migrating. But we should give them a proper space to live. But we are cutting the trees means we are cutting the lives of the animals also. So they're requesting even Bengal tiger, very royal tiger, now begging the people, just leave us to live. That's a pathetic situation today. But no botheration. Species, they're losing their niche, they're losing their habitats, and we are encroaching. And see, this monkey on roadside, it met an accident, and baby is trying to take milk, and one side it's bleeding. They too have families, they too have lives. You should have concern towards the each and every species. Don't think that only one species is important, other species not. Even ant also very important. Even mosquito is also very important. It has its own role to play. That's why nature has given us. Nature, any species it is giving to the earth, any species it is introducing in the form of evolution, it has some idea. It has already designed the species and it released the species into the world. And it also decides some roles to play. But we are not bothering and we are disturbing them. So there again, begging, please don't kill us. And what are the consequences? Once we lose the biodiversity, valuable biodiversity, these are the consequences. Loss of genetic resources. Already we lose many genetic resources. Many plants gone for extinction. And animals gone for extinction. Their genetic resources we lost. Loss of species. Population decline. And see, bird population have come down. Insect population have come down. Wild animals, their population have come down. Plant species, particularly wild plants, their number have come down. So like this, there is a lot of decline in the population size of various species, except human species. Human species population is raising up. Degradation of ecosystems, because of construction. We are using the sites for construction, and area is decreasing day by day. In future, we cannot see even agriculture land for the cultivation. Don't know how to get the food. Ecological imbalance, spread of diseases and pandemics, already we are seeing, facing the present situation is very worse, and cost increase to the society. Everything, see, even we are buying water and oxygen. Future, every planetary resources will become very cost, and only the people who have money, they only can afford, and they cannot. Just imagine what will happen. So biodiversity laws has causes and consequences, and they're all interlinked. They are interlinked. One side, if you disturb, it has impact on other side, and there is a connectivity. So loss of genetic diversity. See, FAO estimates that 75% of crop varieties have been lost during the last 100 years. Just imagine, 75% of crop varieties. Whatever the cultivated plants we are cultivating now, we lost their wild varieties. No wild varieties we are seeing. Only cultivated the two hybrid varieties we are seeing now. All the wild domesticated crops, wild varieties we lost. So 1/3 of these 6,500 domestic livestock races are endangered. So the genetic erosion of crops and livestock threatens food security. So other side, population is increasing. This side, we are losing the valuable genetic resources. How to balance these? And that again putting the imbalance. And transgenic crops can cause the loss of traditional crops, wild relatives, and the centers of origin due to genetic contamination. So now we are seeing we are contaminated the air, we are contaminated the water, contaminated the many things. Now we have started the contamination of genes. So once the contamination of genes takes place, we don't know what will happen. Whether the species will tolerate with the gene, okay. Otherwise, again, some mutations take place, that species may become harmful, and that will have a very bad effect on the environment, particularly human beings. The pandemic, that the COVID we are seeing, every time while spreading, every month or every time during course of spreading, it's altering, changing. So strains are coming out. Some strains, they're losing its virility, but some strains, they're more virulent strains, and they are showing the bad effect on the health and aspects of the people. So 67% secure or apparently secure. This is the current classification of the species. 1% probably extinct, 7% critically imperiled, 8% imperiled, 16% vulnerable, 1% is the other. So 67% only they are secure, remaining all they are under threat. So if we leave, these are all will become extinct, and it shows the effect on these species, and again they will turn to this side. So rare animals we are seeing in the wild, slowly their population is declining, particularly rainforest. Rainforests are the best areas for variation of animals, birds, insects. But with the decreasing population, and many species are putting for trade. This is another problem. And the diversity of species in the rainforest we are seeing now. Actually, this has to be seen. These species have the right to stay in the forest, but our species are roaming in the forest and destructing the forest because of this machinery. Most of the area can be destructed within a short span of time. Very type of machineries we are using for the resource generation and losing the valuable resources, natural resources. And you know, we have a safe water because we have various methods to get the safe water. We dug the bore wells and we drag the water from the bore wells or some other way, some means pipe water we use. But what about animals? No one is caring about animals, birds and all. All the open water resources, rivers, you see the Musi River. Once upon a time, it was drinking water for the Hyderabad. But now it is just a polluted water. Like this, all the open resources, water resources, like ponds, rivers, even oceans also, we contaminated, polluted with many things. And that is left over for animals and birds. Because for drinking this polluted water, they are losing their life. So habitat destruction because of construction. See, deforestation has destroyed 99% of the original temperate forest. 99% of the forests have turned to the this concrete forest, concrete jungle. And agriculture has replaced nearly all grasslands in North America. See, all grasslands were turned to the agriculture lands and other resources also. Dams, construction of dams and other constructions. Putting the habitat destruction. Once the habitat is destructed, the species which are adapted to that habitat, they have to move no other way. They have to move to the other sites. Once they, while moving, and once they move to the other habitats, immediately they cannot adapt. Again, they want to get some adaptations. It has, they should get some time, but no time. Meantime, they are losing their lives. 1 minute. So ecological imbalance, one side floods, other side we are seeing a drought. Worldwide it's happening. There are n number of examples, an outbreak of pandemics, different strains are coming out. We don't know, second wave, we are facing a two phase, another waves. Somebody is saying third, fourth, fifth also, fifth wave is also ready. We don't know how to face. These pandemics have distributed, spread to all parts of the globe. They're not confined to the particular locality, can spread to the all parts of the globe and causing death to the human beings. Now other species are free, they're enjoying the nature, but human we are in enclosures and going with our day-to-day activities. So next part is the conservation of biodiversity. How to conserve the biodiversity? What are the methods to conserve the biodiversity? So there are two methods. One is in situ conservation, other is ex situ conservation. In situ conservation is nothing but on-site conservation. There itself, on-site without causing any disturbance by providing or taking some initiations, we can conserve the diversity. So in these biosphere reserves, national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, and the sacred groves, these are important areas for conservation. And this is the statewide distribution of area under wildlife sanctuaries in India. So every state has its own sanctuaries, and each sanctuary is dedicated to some species for conservation. Of course, once they started these wildlife sanctuaries, declared for conservation sites, many of the species got relief, and they're spreading now. They're increasing their population. So each wildlife sanctuary is dedicated to a particular species, Bengal tiger, green tortoise, in some areas, deer, like this. So these are the national parks. One is located in Hyderabad, that is the Kasabrahma Naidu National Park, where they're conserving the peacock and other species also. They're enjoying the national park. Like this, there are many national parks throughout India, and species are relaxing in these areas. And some sacred groves, distribution of sacred groves in India, they're also helping the species conservation. These are the sites. Nothing but they are the sites where God or Goddess plays, and in the name of God or Goddess, people don't touch the vegetation around it, and they are being conserved. Thank God, because of that, at least some species are putting for conservation, and this is the biosphere reserve actually. So this is a core zone, this is a buffer zone, and so where research and training can be taken place here, some settlements can be seen here, and this green area is a highly conserved area, core area. No one should come there, only some research activities, only restricted entry can be seen in that area, so that no one can cause threat to those organisms. Of species. So here is a list of biosphere reserves. There also, of course, in biosphere reserves, you can see some education and training activities, tourism activities also can be seen. And tourists can come here, but they have a restricted entry. Only up to some extent they can go and see the species which are conserved here. But the core zone is highly restricted. No one can go there. So, ex situ conservation, botanic gardens, gene banks, seed banks, pollen banks, DNA libraries, plant tissue culture. In these methods, we can conserve the endangered plants. We can collect the endangered plant seeds and put it in seed banks and for conservation, and even pollen banks also. For pollination, or sometimes even the pollen can be used for a pollen culture and get hybrid plants later and can treat them with the calcium and get the plant like this. And these are the botanical gardens, various botanical gardens playing an important role in the conservation of rare and endangered plants. And this is a botanical garden of Usmania University, Hyderabad. This to have some endangered rare plants protecting here, and seed bank. This is very important bank which recently they have started. This is called Svalbard Global Seed Vault, where deep inside a mountain on a remote island in the Svalbard archipelago, they started, they constructed this. Just halfway between the mainland Norway and the North Roll lies at a global seed wall. And this is the general construction looks like. These are the vault rooms. Three vault rooms are there. This is the operation center. And this is the corridor. And this is the entrance, what you are seeing here. Okay, this is the entrance. Once you go inside and up to here, you can go. And this is a restricted area. These vault rooms are highly restricted area, where they are storing the, see here, the Svalbard Global Seed Vault is built 150 meters deep into the mountain. They have gone deep, very deep, 150 meters deep into the mountain. And there they built this. And these vault rooms are filled with the seeds. Almost from the each and every country, they have collected the seeds of each and every species and they are storing here. So whenever any species is under threat, they want to conserve, they can get the seeds from here and they can start multiplying. So they don't want to put the trees or plant species for threat. For that reason, they have collected all the seeds from different parts of the world and they are storing here. Why they have chosen this mountain? Because it's always covered with the ice. So the seeds can be preserved for a long time. So this is one development took place recently. So like this, many seed banks have come out and construct for the conservation of plants. Even recently, there is a news saying that scientists are thinking to construct like this vault in on Moon, so that they can conserve those seeds for a long time. Whenever they require, they can get the seeds from Moon and come here. So don't cut our best friend, that's a plant tree, and plant a tree and add a new friend in your life. Start planting trees, at least on your birthday, one tree every year, so that how much your lifespan, that many number of trees can be grown. So thank you all, and hope you have got some information from this lecture. And again, once again, I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. If you have any questions, doubts, again, over to organizers. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And really, it's been a very informative, impressive, and crystal clear session I have ever seen. And really, we felt very glad. And of course, sir, biodiversity, the life of all the creatures. Okay, so each and every creature has its own intrinsic values. So every organism is unique and precious. So all organisms have to come together for a better world. And as you said, just there is no plants, there is no life existence in the world. And there is no pollination, there are no plants. And there is no insects, there is no pollination. So that's why we got the importance and significance of each and every creature, even though the small and beautiful things in the nature. And I hope everybody was enjoyed a lot. And we are very grateful to you, sir. Really, it's a very informative and impressive session. Thank you. Thank you very much. And we are very glad to be with you, be associate with you here. And now, I welcome our respected D. Sunita ma'am, Department of English, to express the vote of thanks and also can invite the queries from our participants. Ma'am?
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Yes. Yeah, you are clear.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all dignitaries, and we respect nature, nature respect us. By starting these words, I would like to say my warm wishes to our honorable today keynote speaker, Dr. A. Vijayabhaskar Reddy Garu and our respected principal M. Srinivas Reddy Garu and our principal, vice principal Madam Mashroom Sultana Madam Garu and our IQAC EDC coordinator Hajrat Kaur Madam Garu and today the coordinator of this beautiful webinar session, Badala Tirupati Sir Garu, and our all dignitaries of this session and my dear beloved participants and my dear faculty members. It is an honor for me to have the opportunity to give a vote of thanks on this special day. I, on behalf of the GDC Women Jagityal, extends a hearty vote of thanks to all delegates of the webinar for their presence and contribution to make this seminar extemporary. And sir, special thank you to our today Vijayabhaskar Reddy Garu to give a beautiful the saving of the nature and environment. And thank you, sir, for inspiring and encouraging us with your words on this special day, sir. And I would like to say some of the discussed with us the beautiful webinar, the important points. So the emergencies of COVID-19 has underscored the fact that when we destroy biodiversity, we destroy the system that support human life. And we are intimately interconnected with nature. If we don't care the nature, we can't care ourselves. So ecosystem diversity, SAR also explained in this session, the mega diversity centers of the world, Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador, China, India, and so on. Etc. The reasons for richness of biodiversity also sir explained in detailed description. And biodiversity is the variety of the life on earth. This life is all its space and sizes occur in the content of ecosystem. Ecosystem, it is the diversity of ecosystem, natural communities and habits. In other words, ecosystem diversity refers to the variety of ways that species interact with each other and their environment. And biodiversity is important to most aspect of our life. And SAR also explained this means we value biodiversity both for what it provides to humans and for the value it has in its own right. Utilitarian values includes the many basic needs humans obtain from biodiversity such as food, fuel, shelter, and medicine. And SAR also covered the values that human places on biodiversity. Economic and ecological life support, recreation, culture, and scientific and human impact and nature also, sir, explained in the beautiful way. And also, sir, explained the global importance also and mass ecosystem events and biodiversity or sports and bio geographic zones, magnitude of biodiversity and biodiversity and endemism and umbrella species. And biodiversity may be seen as an intricate web in which each part is interdependent. When one component is changed or removed, the entire system is affected, and this can produce positive or negative consequences. And SAR also explained nature's response to some of the most pressing challenges facing by human today. It provides us with oxygen, purifies the water we drink, ensures fertile soil, and produces the variety of foods we require to stay healthy and resist disease. Life on earth would not be possible without nature services. It is our greatest common good. So we save the nature, nature also saves us. And finally, I would like to say the greatest achievement today, the webinar, 814 members registered in this webinar and 50 viewers are there using in the, they are seeing in the YouTube and 200 more than participants are and now they are participating and listening the beautiful session as explained by the Dr. A. Vijayabhaskar Reddy Garu. And a special thanks to our all the GDC Women Jagityal faculty members and also I would like to say my warm and must not forget to thank the organizing team, our technical team working hard from the session to get the success. And I would like to congratulate all the participants of their achieved participation to get the success. And thank you everyone for giving this opportunity. Thank you, sir.
And before going to end of this session, some of the queries our eminent personalities and professors of different universities, they are asking some of the questions, sir. Please, you. Anybody, sir? Lingana, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving this opportunity. This is audible, sir?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Young and dynamic, legendary assistant professor of botany, Padala Tirupati, sir, and Dr. A. Vijay Bhaskar Reddy, sir. It is a very interesting session, sir, today. Luckily, today I finished. I am working as a NEET faculty in Karnataka, Davangere. So this concept is there in the 15th chapter in NCERT Biology, Biodiversity and Conservation. So I got a lot of information from Dr. Vijay Bhaskar Reddy, sir. Very, very thank you, sir. And you covered a lot of information by giving live examples. I would like to thank all the participants also. Why? Because in this COVID situation, we are utilizing in this manner. So for conducting all those these webinars, I am very thankful to Government Degree College for Women, Jaityal, principal and coordinator, Padala Tirupati sir, and all the staff members. And the sir has given one beautiful quotation, abbreviation, GOD, generator, operator, and destroyer. I felt very happy with that. And also given so many examples, that Kadaknath hens, and very informative, sir. I felt very happy. So it is a milestone contribution of understanding the biodiversity and conservation topic, sir. I felt very happy. And luckily I completed my online class morning only. So with the grace of Shiva, I got the chance to attend this webinar, sir. I felt very happy. After introducing with Padala Tirupati, sir, I improving lot in botany area. Not only botany area, in all aspects. Sir, conducting not only webinars, national webinars, sir, also conducting botany related topics, national level quiz. So I used to attend all the quiz also. So it is very useful to young and young generation, especially. And when I felt more, if I observe the status of Tirupati sir, our Padala Tirupati sir, very informative and motivative. Each and every minute, sir will think you very good information to the society. He will post any information regarding COVID condition. For example, we are suffering, now we are in pandemic, in COVID pandemic. Sir will send a lot of information, lot of status posts regarding COVID situations and a lot of information regarding medicinal plants and their values. And so it is very interesting, sir. I felt very happy by this session. Very, very thank you to Dr. A. Vijay Bhaskar Reddy, sir. I felt very happy. I am from Telangana only. Telangana, Adilabad district, Kadam, sir. I felt very happy by attending this webinar, sir. Thank you very much. Hearty congratulations to all the participants also. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Joshna, madam.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. If the participant wants to ask any queries, you can. So somebody raised their hand, Professor Ashwani K. Dubey. Yeah, you can, sir. You can unmute yourself and you can ask.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for organizing beautiful conference during this pandemic time. I am Dr. Ashwani Kumar Dubey from Khajuraho, Madhya Pradesh. Working as a professor in Sri Krishna University, Chhatarpur. About biodiversity, our professor, Dr. Reddy Garu, explained very well. So we have only one question. It's not for only me, but it's for all. As we know that we have to do sustainable development, but our government policy is just opposite. So what we can do for that? It's a major discussion for all over our India and all state also. that sometime government start deforestation as work for some industrial area or for road development and some other development name. But they are unable to plant that for plants which which destroyed by the particular agencies. What we can do for that? Are you getting my point?
Yes, yes, sir.
So it's very difficult, sir.
Actually, I don't want to blame the government here. Actually, I want to blame the lay person. Even we have to take blame on our own. Because government many times consider huge sectors and go for policies. But at micro level, what our efforts require for conservation, we ignore. If we do such a small things also, will contribute a lot to the nation. So our efforts enough to enhance the or protect the biodiversity than the policies, whatever the policy it is. Of course, every policy has pros and cons. We don't need to go detail of that. Micro level, at our level, we put a small efforts that can give a big result to the nation. That's enough, sir. Yeah, we don't need to blame anyone here. Because
of course, that is there at micro level, at a genetic level, we can do work in our lab.
Yeah.
But after all, such kinds of plant, I often see that 40 years, 45 years, 50 years plant we are cutting by the name of development. So it's not, I think it's not
of good. Course, sir. Yes, sir. Some NGO organizations opposing this attitude of the governments and different means they have started and they are conserved also. I think a national park which is located in Hyderabad, Kasi Brahmanand National Park, government like to construct one bridge, but people opposed and they stopped it. So like this, many NGOs responding properly and opposing the policies also.
That is there, but I want to add one more thing, that some government college and government university and private university, they should take action against them also, and they can raise the voice against some government who are doing such kind of things. Of course, that is a big problem.
Instead of raising voice against the governments, we can form different clubs in the colleges, like Nature Club, Biodiversity Club, or science club, and motivate the children or students towards the protection of the biodiversity, local areas, local level. So just think locally and work globally. You can see the impact globally. If you work locally, you can see the impact globally. But we never...
Local to vocal. Yes, that we can do.
Yeah,
we
can do. These clubs can help, sir, motivate students.
Government should also be sensitive about that. Thank you very much, sir. You have very well explained. And I have noted your mobile number also. In future, I will be happy if you some lecture for our university and our volunteer who are working in environmental field. Sir, Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And I hope everybody have enjoyed a lot the session. Education with enjoyment can be proved again. So really, it's a very, very impressive session for all, sir. And we are very grateful to you. And again, I'm congratulating all the team members and all the organizing committee. Yes, sir.
అందరికి అవకాశం ఇచ్చాను, అందరికి మాట్లాడడానికి అవకాశం ఇచ్చాను. ఒకసారి మీరు చూడండి.
ఓకే సార్. ఓకే, సో సార్ హాస్ అన్మ్యూటెడ్ ఎవ్రీవన్, సో ఇఫ్ ఎనీబడీ వాంట్స్ టు స్పీక్ ఎనీథింగ్ యూ కెన్. యా, హుసేన్ షేక్ దే రేజ్డ్ దేర్ హ్యాండ్. You can, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, you can.
So I have a question regarding the seed banks. You talked about seed banks, that it, in mountainous regions, they are constructed. So if we are constructing the seed banks in mountainous regions, you said that the temperatures are low. That's why it's feasible, so that the seeds can be preserved. So is it possible that in every mountainous region, so because the climatic conditions will vary in different regions, so is it only about those regions where the climatic conditions are suitable for the preservation of the seeds?
Yeah, only cool climatic conditions are better, and that mountain region is more suitable. And construction of such a huge structures is not a simple thing. So one for a globe, with that motto they have constructed. I think that's enough for the needs of the entire
areas can also be suitable.
They have to spend a huge amount on that. Yes, yes, there are many suitable areas, but thing is financial aspects. To spend more financial resources and construct such huge structures. 150 meters depth into the mountain means it's not a simple thing, and it won't happen within a day. It takes years for such construction. So that's why they have gone with one huge structure. It will serve the needs of all nations. That's the main motto.
Thank you so much, sir, for this informative session.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. And some other participant also raised their hand. Hussein Sheikh. Sir, actually, you're not in mute. You're unmuted, sir.
Yeah, I given to all the participants to unmute themselves. If any queries, please you. All of you, all the participants, please. Any query? Surendra Reddy, sir. Then, Chandraya, sir. Surendra Reddy, sir. Chandraya, sir.
Hello.
Devendra Reddy, sir. Yeah, hello. Yeah, it's audible. It's
hello,
audible, sir. Audible.
Anjanel, sir.
Yeah. Anjanel, sir. Sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome.
Sir, this program is very excellent, and it is full about the biodiversity. It will give more knowledge about the Paryavarnam, these all conditions, and day by day, what is the position of the Paryavarnam biodiversity, and how it is affects to the these all animals and birds, and all the position of the climate and species. It is very useful and a very wonderful program, sir. Thank you very much, Padala Tirupati Rao Garu, who conducted this program from Jagatyal College. I am making my congratulations to them. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much to given this opportunity.
Sir, thank.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. You are from?
From Kavita Memorial Degree College, Khammam. I am the vice principal of Kavita Memorial Degree College, Khammam. Vice principal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. This is Surendra Reddy.
Surendra Reddy, sir. Please welcome.
good afternoon, everyone. I, Surendra Reddy, lecturer in botany, Government Degree College, Khammam, Autonomous. I am very much happy to hear the class. Actually, ఇది మనకి డిగ్రీ ఫైనల్ ఇయర్ లో ఫిఫ్త్ సెమిస్టర్ లో ఉన్న టాపిక్ మొత్తం కవర్ చేశారు. యాక్చువల్గా లెక్చరర్గా నేను ఎప్పుడు క్లాస్ చెప్పిన విధానం ఎవరు, కానీ ఈ రోజు టాపిక్ మొత్తంలో ఒక స్టూడెంట్గా ఈ క్లాస్ని మొత్తాన్ని ఫాలో అయ్యాను. నాకు చాలా ఎంజాయ్ చేశాను. యాక్చువల్గా ఏంటంటే ఈ బయోడైవర్సిటీ టాపిక్ అనగానే స్టూడెంట్స్ అందరు కానీ లెక్చరర్స్ కానీ ఒక రకమైన అంత ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్గా అనిపించదు ఒక్కోసారి, కానీ ఈ రోజు టాపిక్ని నేను చాలా ఎంజాయ్ చేశాను. సార్ కూడా చాలా సింపుల్గా ప్రతిదాన్ని చాలా డీటెయిల్డ్గా ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ చేశారు. ఈ టాపిక్ మాత్రం చాలా నాకు బాగా నచ్చింది. ఈ సెషన్ మాత్రం ఈ నేను నాకు అనిపించింది ఈ ప్రోగ్రాన్ని కనుక మా పిల్లలకి కనుక వినిపించుంటే చాలా బాగుండేదని ఇప్పుడు అనిపిస్తుంది నాకు. నాకు కొద్దిగా ముందు ఉండేటైతే మా పిల్లలను కూడా యాడ్ చేసామని. ఇది వెరీ ఇన్ఫర్మేటివ్ సెషన్. అట్నే మన తిరుపతి గారికి నేను థ్యాంక్స్ చెప్తున్నాను నాకు ఈ అవకాశం ఇచ్చినందుకు. నెక్స్ట్ డే క్లాసెస్ వీలుంటే మా పిల్లల్ని కూడా దీన్ని యాడ్ చేసే ప్రయత్నం చేస్తాను. నెక్స్ట్ డే టుమారో క్లాసెస్కి మా ఫైనల్ ఇయర్ పిల్లల్ని, ఫస్ట్ ఇయర్ పిల్లల్ని ఈ క్లాస్కి యాడ్ చేయడానికి మీరు పర్మిషన్ ఇవ్వమని కూడా కోరుతున్నాను. ఎందుకంటే యాక్చువల్గా ఫిఫ్త్ సెమిస్టర్ ఎగ్జామ్ టోటల్ సిలబస్ అంతా కవర్ అయింది ఇంట్లో బయోడైవర్సిటీ అంతా కూడా. చాలా డీటెయిల్డ్గా బ్రీఫ్గా చెప్పారు. నాకు ఐఎమ్ వెరీ మచ్ హ్యాపీ. థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్. తిరుపతి సార్ థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్. అట్లనే విజయభాస్కర్ రెడ్డి గారికి, ఉస్మాన్ యూనివర్సిటీ విజయభాస్కర్ రెడ్డి సార్కి, అసిస్టెంట్ ప్రొఫెసర్ ఆఫ్ బోట్నీ సార్కి నేను వెరీ మచ్ థ్యాంక్స్ చెప్తున్నాను. ఎందుకంటే చాలా డీటెయిల్డ్గా ఈ లెవెల్లో గ్రౌండ్ లెవెల్కి వచ్చి కూడా సార్ చెప్పారు. యాక్చువల్గా డీటెయిల్డ్గా మాకైతే బాగా నచ్చింది ఈ ప్రాసెస్ చెప్పే విధానం. చాలా డీటెయిల్గా చెప్పిన విధానం బాగా నచ్చింది. థ్యాంక్ యూ సార్.
Thank you, Surendra Reddy sir. Thank you. This session is already in live on YouTube, sir. Please you search plant systematics, biodiversity and environment. You can, when you are searched in YouTube, it is available, sir. Please you watch this YouTube. Your students are sent to your students also.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And now, okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Any queries, sir? Dr. Sudhir sir, Vidya Jha sir, please unmute yourself. Dr. Uma Maheshwari sir. Any queries sir? Chandraya sir. డాక్టర్ ఉత్తర మేడం గారు, డాక్టర్ మనోరమ మేడం గారు, డాక్టర్ పార్వతి మేడం గారు
సార్, తిరుపతి సార్,
మేడం
హియర్ వన్ ఆఫ్ ది పార్టిసిపెంట్ హుస్సేన్ షేక్, దే
హలో,
యా, హి ఇస్ సేయింగ్ దట్ హి ఇస్ అనేబుల్ టు అన్మ్యూట్ హింసెల్ఫ్.
మేడం, ఇస్ ఇట్ ఆడిబుల్? ఐ యామ్ షేక్ హుస్సేన్ స్పీకింగ్.
యా, ఇట్స్ ఆడిబుల్ సార్, ప్లీజ్ యు.
Okay. Good afternoon to all. I am Sheikh Hussain, biodiversity researcher from Hyderabad, Telangana. So I had been working in different biodiversity projects. So I know Vijay Bhaskar Reddy sir's through few webinars and I had seen him previous talks also. Wonderful. Congratulations to the organizers and thank you Vijay Bhaskar Reddy sir for spreading the biodiversity topic into your different topics, different levels, parts by dividing that. And you explained it very well. Though there are some few facts which have to be corrected. Actually, the hotspot biodiversities are 36 now. So it has been given in your presentation, it is 25. And in India, we have 4 hotspot biodiversities. So it's a small suggestion. And the second thing is in Hyderabad, we have 3 national parks, not only one. We have 3 national parks. The only place in Telangana where we have national parks is Hyderabad. So rest of the things, I will speak to you personally, sir. And regarding that, Professor Ashwini Dube sir has asked about the government pro-development things. Yes, we need development also. We need conservation also. So I wanted to add you a few points, sir, with your permission. So I wanted to say that whenever any policy comes from government, so we can go through PIL to the government and ask what is the status, why they are going ahead and what will be the economic benefit of that. If not, we can hinder that whenever there will be a notification that this project is going to happen and there will be a public interest which the public has to express, that the project has to go on or it has to be hindered. Whenever the public has accepted that, then only the project will be going ahead. So that is what it happens with all the projects. So we can involve into that. That notification comes in the newspapers generally. So that is what it happens. It is related to environmental impact assessment and 2006 amendments of Environmental Protection Act. 2006 Environmental Protection Act amendments. So this is what it happens. So thank you, sir. Thank you for that. Thank you for giving me opportunity to participate.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir. Hussain, sir. Sir, please. Any queries, sir? Please you. Unmute yourself and interact with our today's chief guest and keynote speaker, sir. Please, anybody. Dr. Parvati Madam Garu, Dr. Rajini Aluru. Dr. Shankar, sir. Any queries, sir? Madam, any queries? Okay, just now, Madam Ji.
Yes, sir. Yeah, okay, thank you, everyone. It's time to conclude the session. And first of all, we are very grateful to our keynote speaker, Dr. A. Vijayabhaskar Reddy Garu, for a wonderful adorable session for us. So really, it's a very informative session for all the students and even to the lecturers also. And we congratulate all the organizing committee and all the departments of JDCW. Yeah, advisory committee and all the committees of JDCW Jagatyal. And of course, we hope that you got the significance of biodiversity. So each and every creature is valuable in this universe. So first, we have to protect all the creatures. It's our responsibility as a human being, because now the human race is moving towards the ancient methods to cure themselves in this pandemic situation. They are following the ancient medical values, medical products and everything. So they are going to nature and we are buying oxygen nowadays. So this shows, and we can imagine how precious the nature is. So it was clearly shown and portrayed by our keynote speaker, Dr. A. Vijayabhaskar Reddy Garu. Sir, we are very grateful to you, sir. You have given such a wonderful session for us. And the session will continue tomorrow also. It never ends process. Of course, after the completion of this webinar, we'll go on with some more also. And now it's a time to conclude the session with shares. And I hope everybody was enjoyed a lot. And we'll meet tomorrow at the same time, 11 o'clock. And we'll gather together. Along with the same link and ID. And we'll meet our Vijayabhaskar Reddy sir again and can get a lot of information tomorrow. Thank you everyone for being with us.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah. I'm very thankful. Yes, sir.
Where I have to reach for lunch?
Vijayabhaskar Reddy sir has given a bunch of related to natural resources, natural food materials. So that's why we are enjoy. We are eaten, we are smelled, we are taste, and we are also the admire. We are admirable. We are enjoy. Lots of enjoy within these two and a half hours.
Thank you very much.
We are very happy to see all these kinds of smiling faces in this pandemic situation. Yeah. So, first, really, it's a great pleasure to us.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And we'll meet tomorrow with the same link and same time. Thank you. And also, I'm thanking to Parala Tirupati, sir, and organizing committee for giving this great opportunity.
Okay, madam. Thank you very much. Thanks to all the delegates of
states
and various universities, assistant professor and professors of our country. thanks a lot. And yeah. My personal request to please you join as the same link and same time by tomorrow itself. Thanks a lot.
Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah.
Tirupati, sir. Levy.
Madam?
Yeah, you can. Okay. Yeah, shall I leave, sir?
Leave it alone.